before the talk, may I ask a question? How many of you have used the IoT device or smart devices? Wow, cool, so many of you. If you don't worry. I think you are safer than them. OK, first, please allow me to introduce myself and my team. My name is Yan Jia. I come from School of Civil Engineering, Xidian University in China. The work was done when I collaborated with the guys in University of Chinese Academy of Sciences in China and the Indiana University Bloomington in USA. OK, many years ago, we have already been using the locks, lightnings, plugs, and cleaners. Recently, vendors tell us they become smart. They are smart lock, smart bulb, smart robot, even the smart city. We can control them from our cell phone and see their status. For example, when I'm in London speaking as a black hat, I can open my door from my neighbor through my cell phone, and my neighbor can feed my dog. Naturally, why they are getting smarter? That's all because of the cloud. We send messages to the cloud. The cloud communicates with the devices. That is to say, any manufacturers who want to make their products smart, they need a cloud. But they use it to produce the bulbs. They may have no experience in managing a cloud. So many big cloud service providers stand out and provide such services, like Amazon, Microsoft, IBM. I call them the third-party IoT cloud service. The manufacturers can use their services to connect the traditional accessories easily. First, device manufacturers need to take some configuration on the cloud. For example, configure the credentials of the device, the name, the model, the identity of the devices. The third-party cloud will provide SDK for the manufacturers to configure the device and the mobile app. And the manufacturer will never worry about how to build a cloud themselves. They can rely on the big cloud giant. After that, the user who buy the IoT device can control it through the mobile app. The app sends commands to the message broker on the cloud, and the command is forwarded to the device. So as the device status, the device will send the information to the cloud, and the cloud forwards the device information to the user, and the user can see the device status on his phone. For example, the light is on, your door is locked. Now, various manufacturers can use the service of these third-party clouds. There are locks, bulbs, and the cleaners. The challenge here for the cloud is how to understand what the device are talking about. If I use Chinese to present this talk, I think most of you would run away because you can't understand my language. Protocols are the language of the internet. There are also many languages for the devices to choose from. There are CUAP, HTTP, MQTT, and AMQP, and so on. The cloud side, I like MQTT. Among them, we found MQTT is one of the most popular. First, it is supported by the IoT cloud services of many big cloud providers. For example, the Alibaba, Tuya Smart, Microsoft Azure, AWS, and IBM Watson. By the way, we see the MQTT, the blue line in the picture, attracts more and more attention compared to other protocols like AMQP and CUAP. OK, now let's introduce what is MQTT. The message queuing telemetry transport, MQTT, created in 1999. It is a machine-to-machine, or the Internet of Things connectivity protocol. It was designed as an extremely lightweight publish-subscribe messaging transport. It is useful for the connections in remote locations where the network wide bands is limited. For example, it was used to monitor the oil pipeline by satellite link. Today, it also works in a range of home automation scenarios. In March this year, OASIS released the new version of MQTT, MQTT file. So let's see how MQTT works. MQTT servers forward these messages based on the topics. It's an important concept. Topic is a specific field in MQTT message. If a client sends a message to topic A, the cloud would forward this message to the clients who subscribed to the topic A. Let's see how MQTT works in the IoT scenario. Imagine you have smart conditioners. First, the MQTT session begins with the connect message from the clients. Then, the clients need to subscribe to a topic for receiving the messages. For devices in the picture, the air conditioner may subscribe to its own topic identified by its device ID. See the red text in this picture. The device ID slash command. The app can publish messages directly to this topic, and the device will receive the command from the app. Similarly, if the app wants to receive messages from the device, it should subscribe to the topic which the device publishes message to. In this picture, see the blue text, the app would subscribe to the device ID slash status topic. So now the question is MQTT secure? The answer is no, because previous works did by Lucas and Federico demonstrate that a malicious MQTT client can easily subscribe to wildcards to gather all the messages on the broker in wild. There's no authentication and no authorization. But let's see what protection the bigger cloud providers put in place. First, they use SSL in case of a man in the middle. The client verifies the server's certificate. Then the server also needs to authenticate the client. It may check the certificate client provided in the SSL. It may check the username or password provided in MQTT Connect message. Or it may require the identity tokens from the client. But whatever chosen by the cloud, MQTT session begins only after the client is authenticated. There are also authorizations put in place by the cloud. Some clouds provide a flexible policy that can be customized by the manufacturers, for example, AWS IoT. And some providers provide the access control template. But whichever the way is, the client can only access its own topic. For example, the plug in the picture, it can only subscribe to the topic start with plug. It can never subscribe to the topic of a lock. So is MQTT real secure? To answer this question, we did a systematic security study on the leading IoT clouds in the world who are using MQTT, including Alibaba, Microsoft, AWS. First, the usage scenario of MQTT becomes different with its original usage scenario. In the original usage scenario, it is used to monitor the private devices. But today, various devices use MQTT to talk to each other, and as smart devices, they can be shared by different people. For example, a hotel customer or an Airbnb customer may use a smart lock. You check in, and you can control the lock. After you check out, you lose the control of the lock, right? Or you are never able to open the door when the same room is used by the later customer. This introduces some interesting attacks. Let's see the attack one. Unauthorized MQTT messages. Before the attack begins, we need some background of the real message in MQTT. It is an optional payload in the connect message. It carries the topic and the contents. The contents can be the command, for example, start your device. And this message will be published by the server when client disconnects accidentally. You can see from the picture, this feature of MQTT is to tell the user, hey, your device has some problems when the device internet is disconnected. The cloud will send this real message to the user, notifying the user, your device is offline. Note that this real message will be triggered when the device goes offline accidentally. Utilizing this feature, an attacker who uses the device once can illegally control the device forever. First, when he has the usage right, he registers a real message on the cloud. For example, the message carrying the command turn on the device. Then the device is reset and used by another user, which means the right of the previous owner is revoked, and the attacker can't publish to the topic of the device directly anymore. However, the registered view message still works. Remember, the message is registered when attacker has the usage right. He can go offline at any time he wants, say, when the device is used by another user to trigger the command in this view message. Please note that this attack bypasses the security property of the cloud. The ownership is transferred to the victim already. Let's see a video demo. The attacker used this tablet, and now he has the control right of the iRobot. the mobile phone is used by the victim. Now the attacker can't control the device from this tablet. Okay, now the attacker goes offline, and this will trigger the real message registered on the cloud. The IoT is controlled by the attacker. Okay, the returned message also has a similar issue. It's a normal message with the returned flag set to be true. When accepted by the server, it is stored on that topic. Any clients subscribed to this topic will receive this returned message. Returned message can also be used by the attacker. The attacker can store a message on the server when he has usage right. Whenever the device subscribes to its topic, it will receive commands from the attacker, even though the attacker's permission is revoked. Let's further discuss why this would happen. We communicate with the MQTT technical community. They said MQTT is designed to be so. The real message is accepted at the time it is set. The act of the acceptance grants the permission for it to be delivered at a later time. The client is out of the picture. This issue is under open discussion now. You can find more details on OASS open issue MQTT 536 and the mail list of the MQTT comment. The second attack is about managing the MQTT sessions. When the ownership transferred from the attacker to victim, the attacker can use the fault in managing sessions to illegally receive the status of device. We know that MQTT starts with a connect message from the client. MQTT life cycle session begins after the cloud accepts this connect message from the client. And once the client subscribes to a topic, the server will maintain a subscription session. The messages on that topic will be continuously sent to the device until a device sends an unsubscribe message. The unsubscribe message is also a type of MQTT message. At last, the client can send the disconnect to end the MQTT session. The problem here is an attacker can never actively send the unsubscribe message. According to the protocol, the subscription session will be maintained by the server, even though his permission has been revoked. Also, he can never disconnect. He just keep the connection and receiving the messages from the cloud. Now, let's see how this problem affects a real-world vendor, Tuya Smart. Tuya has adopted many security mechanisms. It uses application layer symmetrical encryption. Also, the encryption key updates along with the owner of the device. If you do not know the key or get the encrypted messages, you can't control the device or know what the device is talking about. At last, the credentials of the device will be updated too, so as to prevent the device identity forgery. However, as I said earlier, once the attacker obtained the credential of the device once, he can forge the device by keeping MQTT sessions. Now, let's see the procedure of our impersonation attack on Tuya Smart. The attacker needs two scripts. One stands for the app. We call it script app, to receive the messages from the victim device, leveraging the subscription session flow. Another is a script that stands for the device, to replay the status message to the victim's app. First, when the attacker has the usage right of the device, he uses the script app subscribe to the topic of victim device. Again, as I introduced before, if the attacker does not send unsubscribe, he will keep receiving messages from the device. Meanwhile, the attacker uses the credentials of the device to craft a scripted device and keep it online. Then, though the device is reset and used by another user, the victim, and updated the key, the attacker can obtain the messages that are encrypted by the new key. So the attacker can use the script device to publish a fake status to the victim. Let's see a video demo. Now the attacker uses cell phone. Now the right of the attacker is revoked. Now the status of the device is on, but the victim's app shows it's off because it receives the fake message from the attacker's script device. Okay, let's further consider why this could happen. MQTT specification says the server may use a security component to authorize particular actions on the topic resource for a given client. It should authorize the connect, the subscribe, or the publish message. They are all actions, but the session is not in the picture. Meanwhile, the MQTT session is managed by the client by design. The client sends subscribe, unsubscribe, or disconnect. But everyone we know, we shouldn't trust the client. A good news is that MQTT 5 allows disconnect to be sent by the server. Now, the attack does not require the attacker uses the device before the victim. Let's see the attack 3, an authenticated MQTT identity. First, let's review how the cloud authenticates clients. The authenticate usually happens independent of MQTT by using the client certificate. After authenticated, the client sends MQTT connect message to the cloud. In the connect message, MQTT requires a client identifier. We call it client ID. The client identifiers identify the client to the server. Each client connecting to the server has a unique client ID. If the two clients claim the same client ID, the later one will kick the connected one off. This is by design of the MQTT specification. It also says that the server must allow a client ID as short as one byte. Let's see how the vendors understand the client ID. IBM suggests that MAC address can be used as a client ID. Although we all know that a MAC address only have 24 bits to change given a vendor. Some vendors prefer using the serial number, which is also guessable. The last thing is that client ID is used to identify a device as a constant string. For a device, it won't never change. Let's see the attack. The client ID of iRobot Ruba looks like a 16-digit serial number. Specifically, from our own device client ID, we try to increase or decrease the number based on our device number to generate potential device IDs of other robots. Finally, we got a web API of iRobot by reverse engineering to complete the queries. And we successfully found 10,000 client IDs in use in a few hours. Most importantly, we found that we can change the client ID of the mobile app arbitrarily. That is to say, now we can change the client ID of our app to the other robot's devices. Now, and we can kick off those 10,000 robots. That kidding, that is not legal. So we just a POC attack. We only kick our own robot offline. To confirm, we can do it in a large scale. On our own AWS endpoint, we use one client identity, keeps 2,000 concurrent connections. The client ID hijacking can also be used to hijacking the session if the clean session flag in the connect message is set to false. But why can this happen? First, MQTT specification never said client ID is a secret. The second, no feature provided by IoT clause to restrict the client ID. sometimes manufacturers have nothing to do because the cloud doesn't have this function. Third, the misleading development guides fulfill the internet. For example, the figure shows a security policy of AWS IoT are copied from the AWS blog. The red text in the rectangle $IoT colon client ID or asterisk allows the client to claim whatever client ID they want. Finally, we found 68% policies recommended by AWS and 85% on GitHub projects use this risky policy. Okay, the last attack, the problems of the topics. The wildcard in topic allows a subscription matches multiple topics. However, when it comes to the policy of AWS IoT, wildcard in topic brings new risk. On the iRobot's AWS endpoint, we found a client can create any topics as long as it satisfies the requirement. For example, you can create a topic start with botnet as long as the topic ends in the black text. You can see the topic is for your mobile app to command your robot. It means that you can buy one robot and you can get one AWS IoT service free because you can create lots of clients using your app's credentials, sending and receiving messages. A robot will pay the money for you because all the messages are forwarded by the iRobot's endpoint on AWS. I never told you that you can create a botnet in this free way. Okay, at last, the wildcard hashtag again. We found even at commercial cloud, wildcards can also cause problems. These are the messages we got. They are in JSON format, and we can see many metadata from the messages. To see what impact, we gathered 800 million real-world MQTT messages from a popular smart home cloud. We observed that the messages leak PII information, like email, phone number, and lots of device information. For example, the status, the location, and the information captured by the device. The information includes the temperature or the air quality and so on. Even an attacker can know your cohabitants' relation if you made some personal configuration. We could see from the message that the person name you set by the user. For example, Smith opens the door. It comes from the message, so we can know you live with the Smith. This figure shows a air conditioning status of a device. We observe it 3 weeks. The red point means the air conditioner is working. We can see from the figure, it starts from usually starts from the 6 a.m. and ends in the middle night. Imagine if you were a burglar, according to the message, which day would you choose to break into the victim's home? If ever, I would choose the Thursday because the air conditioner was shut down the whole day. It may mean that the host may not at home on Thursday. Okay, last, let's see what lessons we learned from these attacks. The first and the most important one is be carefully applying a common purpose protocol to your application. The original scenarios of the protocol in design may not suit for your application scenario. You need to make your own security customizations very carefully. For MQTT, remember to guard the client ID. You need to build the tie of platform layer identity and the client ID. Second, you need to guard various messages. Clients should never accept messages from previous users. Then you should guard the sessions, not only the actions. Please consider sessions in authorization model, even you extend the state of the protocol. And last, and the most important, please guard the resources. Consider specific syntax feature of the protocols. That's all. Thank you, everyone.